Hey, everybody, I'm Ronette Rollins, and I want to welcome you tonight to a Praise 104.1 Spring Revival. I don't know about you, but I sure do need to be revived. It's so much happening in our world, and we just need a word from God to encourage us and help us to keep pushing on. So yeah, we want to thank our sponsors, Living Well, leading people to healthier and more spiritually meaningful lives. They're located at 12004 Cherry Hill Road in Silver Spring, Maryland. You can visit them online at www.livingwellabc.com. So let's jump right into it. Tonight, I'm so excited to hear from this brother. He's a true worshiper in Christ, and he worships through his music. He is the author of his current single, Beautiful Savior, and I love the duet that he had that features Tasha Page. Would you please welcome Brian Poppin?
Because you know. divine protection. Thank you for healing. Thank you for grace. Thank you for mercy. Thank you for second chances, third chances. My God, my God. Come on, if you're thankful at all, right where you are, give them a shout of praise.
Thank you so much, Brian. We really appreciate you for taking the time to join us and bless us at our spring revival. All right, now it's time for the Word of God. Joining us for this second night of our revival is Dr. Maurice Watson. He's the pastor of the Metropolitan Baptist Church in Largo, Maryland. Dr. Watson is a prolific pastor with a dynamic, itinerant preaching ministry that extends around the globe. You hear his radio broadcast ministry each Sunday evening at 6:30 p.m. right here on Praise 104.1. And tonight, we are so excited that he's with us. So let's get ready to hear an anointed word coming from Dr. Maurice Watson, the pastor of the Metropolitan Baptist Church in Largo, Maryland.
Psalm 118, one of the messianic psalms of the Old Testament. Psalm 118, and I want to read into your hearing verses 19 through 29. Psalm 118, verses 19 to 29. I know that's a long text, but we need to read the Bible more, don't we? Amen, amen. I'm reading from the New King James Bible. If you found it, might you indicate as such by saying amen. Here's how my Bible reads. Open to me the gates of righteousness. I will go through them, and I will praise the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous shall enter. I will praise you, for you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Save now, I pray, O Lord, I pray, send now prosperity. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you from the house of the Lord. God is the Lord, and he has given us light. Bind a sacrifice with cords to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, I will exalt you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Look again at verse 24. We recite it all the time. Here it is. This is the day the Lord has made. we will rejoice and be glad in it. Will you look at your neighbor, even in your homes and or wherever you may be, and tell him or her, it's still the day. It's still the day. It's still the day. There are some days that are etched on the hard drive of our memory, events that we will never forget. For some, it is December the 7th, 1941, the day Japan attacked Pearl Harbor. President Roosevelt described it as a day that would live in infamy. For others, it is the events that happened on November the 22nd, 1963, and April the 4th, 1968, the dates on which President John F. Kennedy and Martin Luther King Jr. were assassinated are days that you'll never forget. More recently, the tragic events of September the 11th, 2001 will never leave our memory. Many of us can remember the joy and excitement that we experienced on November the 4th, 2004, when Barack Obama was elected the 44th president of the United States. For some of you, your unforgettable day is your wedding day. For others, it is the births of your children. These, friends, are days that contain memories that are hardwired on our minds, and they will live with us until the day we die. The ancient nation of Israel observed feasts in which they were also required to remember important days in their history. One of them was known as the Feast of Tabernacles. During this feast, the people of God would make a pilgrimage to the temple in Jerusalem, where they were to remember God's provisions for their forefathers and mothers during their exodus from Egypt and their exile from Babylon. These, friends, were considered as unforgettable events in the life and history of the people of Israel, and they gathered together during the Feast of Tabernacles in order to give thanks to God for God's faithfulness. Psalm 118 is a Thanksgiving liturgy that was sung during the Feast of Tabernacles. The worshiping congregation sang this psalm antiphonally, with one choir answering another. This psalm is believed to have been Martin Luther, the great reformer's favorite psalm. And it is also considered to be the hymn that Jesus and his disciples sang at the end of the Passover meal in the upper room on the night that he was betrayed by Judas. The writer says that when at the end of the meal, that when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Some scholars believe that the hymn that they sang that night was that they sang Psalm 118. The psalm pictures a worshiping throng of people in procession marching to the temple in Jerusalem. It opens in verses 1 and 29 with a call to thanksgiving. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. These words would serve not only as the theme of this magnificent psalm, but also as fitting bookends that would call the people of God to remember God's goodness and to rejoice in light of God's saving actions. In verses 5 through 18, a king or a liturgist encourages the congregation to remember how when death and disaster seemed imminent upon their forefathers and mothers in Egypt and in Babylon, but God stepped in on each and every occasion and turned their situation around. Now we come to verse 19, and when we come to verse 19, the crowd has now arrived at the gate of the temple. So now the king sings on behalf of the waiting congregation his part in verse 19. He says, "Open to me the gates of righteousness, and I will go through them." Some believe that the gate that he refers to, the eastern gate of the temple. In verse 20, the gatekeepers, the priests, respond antiphonally. They're singing back and forth. respond in verse 20. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous shall enter. In other words, only the righteous can enter these gates, or as the psalmist said, he who has clean hands and a pure heart. Once inside the gate, then the king, speaking on behalf of the worshiping assembly, stated yet again his reason for being there. He says, I will praise you, for you have answered me and have become my salvation. And then after the congregation enter, if you will, into the temple, finally in verses 22 and following, the congregation began to sing their part, and in a public act of worship, they stated in an antiphonal fashion their corporate responsibility to remember God's goodness and to rejoice in light of his saving actions on that high watermark day of the Feast of Tabernacles. They declared, this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. That day had been set aside as a national feast, and they worshiped God because of his goodness. As they saw it, friends, only God could make that day happen for them. So they said, we will rejoice and be glad in it. I submit to you today that while that day of remembrance is a day that should not be relegated solely to the events of Israel's past. No, like Israel, we also have reasons to rejoice. We can likewise look back over our lives and the many expressions of God's goodness and grace and declare with Israel, this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. In other words, it's still the day. That day has not changed. It's still the day when we ought to rejoice and remember God for his goodness. While as New Testament believers, that day has not been codified as a national feast. Make no mistake about it. It's still the day when we ought to rejoice. While our circumstances may not be the same as Israel, our reasons for rejoicing have not changed. No, friends, it's still the day when we ought to rejoice and give the Lord praise. I submit to you that Israel's example for us, it shows us today a fitting example of why we ought to rejoice and be glad on this day. I submit to you today that it's still the day to rejoice, because first of all, this is the day to remember how God reversed our predicament. This is the day to remember how God reversed our predicament. As the congregation sang their part and responded, they responded with this proverb, or well-known or wise saying in verse 22. They said, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This proverb depicts in a graphic picture the great reversal of their predicament. When their forefathers and mothers were surrounded by enemies down in Egypt and over in Babylon, later in Babylon, they looked, if you will, like worthless stones that the builders or masons would throw away as unfit. But God stepped into their situation and reversed the situation and made Israel the chief cornerstone, the capstone, the keystone, the most important stone that holds everything else in the building together. That stone that had been rejected represented Israel at her point of death until the Lord stepped in and turned things around and made them the chief cornerstone. Continuing their part, singing their part, the congregation said of that miraculous reversal of their circumstances in verse 23, for this is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. I want to remind someone today that it's still the day when we ought to rejoice, because like Israel, many of us know what it feels like to experience God step in in to our situation and turn things around. Like Israel, many of us know what it feels like to be rejected, to be treated like stones that the builders throw away as unfit, to be rejected, if you will. For some, you know the pain of rejection, the rejection of being put up for adoption in your by a biological parent. Others know that pain as having been qualified for a job, but you were overlooked and they gave the job to someone less qualified than you. Others know the pain of being madly in love with someone, but they broke your heart because they rejected you and left you for someone else. And every one of us perhaps knows the pain of being rejected on the basis of the color of our skin. But regardless of the reason, rejection hurts. I said rejection hurts. And it causes a person to question their self-worth and to ask questions of themselves like, what's wrong with me? Am I not good enough? Am I not pretty enough? Am I too skinny? Am I too fat? Am I not smart enough? But friends, the good news of this text is that God can take the rejects, the throwaways, the stones that the builders rejected and turn things around and make them the chief cornerstone. It is said that in the days of Michelangelo, there was in Florence, Italy, an 18-foot slab of marble that none of the other sculptors or artists would have anything to do with that slab of marble because they considered it to be inferior in quality. Michelangelo studied the slab and said to the curators, "Give the slab of marble to me." And from a stone that had been rejected, Michelangelo sculptured, if you will, perhaps the most beautiful sculpture in world history, his sculpture of King David. From a stone that had been rejected, he created a masterpiece. And is that not a picture in miniature of the gospel? Ephesians 2 says of you and me that we are God's workmanship. That word literally means masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. That God took rejects like you and me with all of our faults and all of our flaws and all of our failures and made us his masterpiece, and he included us in his salvific purposes. I submit to you, friends, that the chief example of this rejected stone was our Lord Jesus Christ. He also knew the pain of rejection. Hundreds of years before he was born in Bethlehem, the prophet Isaiah said of him that he was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrow and acquainted with grief. John the apostle said of him in his gospel that he came unto his own, but his own did not receive him. The religious leaders of Jesus' day rejected him, but Jesus didn't allow the opinions of his opponents to cause him to forget who he was. He took these same words in Mark chapter 12 of Psalm 118 and ascribed them to himself. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. In his darkest hours, as he hang out on Calvary's cross, Jesus looked like a stone that the builders had rejected. He looked rejected and dejected. Oh, but early Sunday morning, God turned his situation around and raised him from the dead with all power in his hand. Oh, child of God, that's the hope of our faith, that God can turn our situations around, that when it seems like we are defeated, God steps into our situations and reverses our predicament. Paul said to the Corinthians, "Thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph in Christ," that no matter how bad our circumstances may look at any one given hour, God has given us victory instead of defeat. That's why I can boldly stand before you tonight and declare, this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, because we've seen over and over again how God has stepped in and turned things around. Is that not, friends, a picture of what God did for black people in this country? Our forefathers and mothers did not come to this country on cruise ships. No, they came on slave ships. They were sold as slaves, as property, torn away from family, friends, and loved ones, treated as three-fifths of a person. They had to face Jim Crow laws and voter suppression and all of the ugly expressions of racism. And here we are in the 21st century fighting those same battles. We now face the new Jim Crow. We face police brutality and voter suppression and mandatory sentences, and yet from rejects, yet from the stones that the builders have rejected, God has made of us preachers and teachers and doctors and lawyers and scientists and inventors and intellectuals and artists and writers and mayors and senators and governors and yes, even a president, because our God takes the stones that the builders rejected and made us the chief cornerstones. God specializes in turning things around. When you look back through the rearview mirror of your life, can you look back and see how, when you thought you wasn't gonna make it, God stepped in and turned your situation around? When the doors were closed in your face, when the doctor said it was cancer, when the marriage looked like it was over, when your enemy said that counted you out, but God counted you back in. Friends, our God specializes in turning things around. So I am unapologetic when I say this is the day the Lord has made. We ought to rejoice and be glad in it, because our God specializes in turning our situations around. I submit, it's still the day when we ought to rejoice, because this is the day to remember how God reversed our predicament. But it's still the day to rejoice, because this is the day to remember how God answered our prayer. Look at verse 25. The people are singing. They said, save now, I pray, O Lord. O Lord, I pray, send now prosperity. This phrase is believed to have been a formula prayer that was prayed before the blessing would be pronounced in verse 26. When you read verse 25 in the original Hebrew, language, verse 25 has a repetitive flow about it. In the Hebrew, it reads like this: please, Yahweh, save us, please. Please, Yahweh, cause us to prosper, please. But by the first century days of Jesus, that Hebrew statement had been reduced down to one word, Hosanna. Let the church say Hosanna. And Hosanna means save now, Lord. Perhaps these worshiping Israelites remembered how God had heard the cries of their forefathers and mothers in Egypt and over in Babylon. And now they cry out to God to save them from the enemies and from the destruction that they quite possibly could face in the future. So they cried out, Hosanna, save us now, Lord. And in verse 26, the writer indicates that God obviously heard their prayer, because he faithfully showed up as their Savior. Listen to these words. They ought to sound familiar to you, New Testament believers. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The gospel writers use this passage as an acclamation to Jesus. Remember, during his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, as he rode into Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the crowd was throwing palm branches in his path. And guess what the crowd was singing while Jesus was riding into Jerusalem? They were singing from Psalm 118. They were singing, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Now, while these words were spoken not so much as a prayer to Jesus, but as an acclamation of praise to him, I submit that it really could have been their corporate prayer, because Israel and the world needed to be saved. So they said, Hosanna, save now, Lord. Come here, let me ask you a question. Have you ever prayed a Hosanna prayer? Save me now, Lord. I don't have a month. I don't have a week. I don't even have an hour. I need you to step in right now. Hosanna, save now, Lord. If you haven't prayed a Hosanna prayer, that's all right. Just keep living, because one day you will. Oh, friend, life has a way of causing you to face situations that get completely out of your control. These are times, friends, when things are out of your hands, when you've got to learn how to put them in the hands of God. Because time will be of the essence, and you don't have time to try to figure out some long, cute prayer. You just got to learn to pray a Hosanna prayer. Hosanna, save me now, Lord. But can I ask you another question? Have you ever witnessed God answer your Hosanna prayer? Your save now, Lord, prayer? Oh, friends, I'm a living witness that God will answer your prayer just in the nick of time. When I pastored in Omaha, Nebraska, I remember our church was growing at such a rapid pace that we had obviously outgrown our facility, and we needed to build a new and larger sanctuary. And of course, we had applied for a loan at one of the local banks, but the banks was making us jump through all kind of hoops. And all I wanted them to do was say, come on, man, and say, yes, we approve your loan. But they kept giving us a run around. And I remember one day when I was in my car, I was on Dodge Street at the corner of 30th and Dodge. If you ever been to Omaha, Dodge Street is the main thoroughfare that run all the way through the city from east to west. I was at 30th and Dodge, and I was frustrated. And I prayed a prayer of frustration. Can I tell you something? Sometimes your best prayer are frustrated prayer, prayers of frustration. I prayed at 30th and Dodge. I was heading west, if you will. I said, Lord, will you touch the hearts of these bankers so they'll stop giving us the runaround, and God caused them to approve our loan. I kid you not. By the time I got to 60th and Dodge, just 30 blocks later, my phone rang, and it was the banker saying, we approve your loan. In the space that it took me, time that it took me to drive 30 blocks, less than 2 miles, God had answered my prayer. I didn't know it at the time like I know it now, but I was praying a Hosanna prayer. Save now, Lord. And God answered in less than 30 blocks. Do I have a witness? Dottie Peoples was right when she said, he's an on-time God. Yes, he is. He may not come when you want him to come, but he'll be there right on time. So I am unapologetic when I stand before you today to say it's still the day when we ought to say this is the day the Lord has made. We ought to rejoice and be glad in it, because we can look back over our lives at time and time again when God answered our prayers just in the nick of time. But lest I keep you too long, I submit to you lastly that it's still the day when we ought to rejoice, when we ought to give God praise, when we ought to rejoice, because lastly, this is the day to remember God deserves our praise. Look at verse 27. The priests are now singing their part. God is the Lord, and he has given us light. Bind the sacrifice with cords to the horns of the altar. The priests are singing their part and remind the people that God has shown his favor on them. He said he has given us light. Now, when the scripture speaks of God's light shining on God's people, that is a metaphor for the favor of God. The Aaronic prayer, the Aaronic benediction, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you. When the shining shining face of God. That's an anthropomorphic metaphor for the favor of God. Can somebody shout favor? I don't know about you, child of God, but I've learned in this life of mine that sometimes I'd rather have God's favor than to have a pocket full of money. Because you can have a pocket full of money and no doors will open for you. But you can be broke and don't have a dime. But if you got favor, you can make one phone call and doors will begin to open. Somebody shout favor. They said God has shown his favor on us because he's caused his light to shine on us. And since that is the case, they said, we ought to praise God. How do we praise God? They said, bind the sacrifice with cords to the horns of the altar. Now, this is a difficult passage in the Hebrew. The NIV, the New International Version, I believe has a more readable and understandable translation. The NIV reads this verse like this, with boughs in hand, B-O-U-G-H-S, with tree branches, boughs in hand, because they used tree branches during the festivities of the Feast of Tabernacles, with tree branches in hand, join in the festal procession up to the horns of the altar. In other words, they're now inviting the people to dance in a ceremonial dance around the altar. And the king, who is the chief liturgist, is leading the people in verse 28 as he sings his part as they dance around the altar. The king said, you are my God and I will praise you. You are my God and I will exalt you. Now, this praising and dancing during the Feast of Tabernacle was their proper response to their ability to remember God's faithfulness in their lives. Whatever else praise is, praise ought to always be our response to God's faithfulness based on our ability to remember what God has done for us. May we never lose sight of this basic truth, friends, that God deserves to be praised. The basic truth is that as long as breath remains in our bodies, we ought to praise God. Do I have a witness here? The psalmist said in Psalm 150, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. The prerequisite for praise is breath. If you have breath in your body, you ought to praise God. Now, as I've told you, that this praising and this dancing that Israel did at the Feast of Tabernacles was to be done antiphonally. That one choir was to sing their part, but the other choir was to answer back singing their part. They were to sing antiphonal praise. And what better description of true praise than that kind of antiphonal praise? Each group was required to sing their own part. The priests sang their part. The king sang his part. And the people sang their part. No group could sing the other group's part. No, each group had to sing their own part. Do I have a witness here? So that when other people give their reason for praising God, the question that I ask is tonight is, can you sing your part? But can you sing your part even when circumstances are not ideal? When the doctor says it's cancer, can you sing your part? When your marriage is in trouble, can you sing your part? When your children are acting up, can you sing your part? When your money is funny and your change is strange, can you sing your part? Now, you can't sing my part, and I can't sing your part. No, we got to state our own reasons why we praise God. Do I have a witness here? Well, a few years ago, one of the faithful members of our church, who was an usher at our church, faithfully serving the Lord, but she developed cancer. And cancer spread from her breast to all over, just about all over her body. But she was faithful, even up to a couple of weeks before she finally succumbed to cancer. She would come to church every Sunday with tubes hanging out of her body where they were still feeding her the chemo. But she would stand faithfully and had a post on the door. And one Sunday, a couple of weeks before she died, while she was at the door, standing on her post, somebody said, how are you doing? And here was her answer. She said, not good but I'm here. It was her way of shouting back, antiphonally, shouting back against the hellishness of life, that this cancer is not going to stop me from serving God. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. My brothers and sisters, that day has not changed. It's still the day when we ought to rejoice. But I can hear some of you thinking out loud right now, he doesn't know what I'm going through. That's easy for him to say. He don't know the pressure I'm under just to get to church today. And you are right. I don't know what you're going through, but what I do know is this, that it don't matter whatever you're going through, you still ought to give God praise, because the saying is true. It's not what happens to you, but how you respond to what happens to you that makes all the difference. You can hold your head down in shame and self-pity and invite everybody to come to your pity party, or you can declare your antiphonal response against the hellishness of your situation. This is still the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. You've got to learn to shout back at life and say, I know the burdens are heavy, but it's still the day. I know the nights are dark, but it's still the day. I know that trouble is on every hand, but it's still the day. I know I've got problems everywhere I turn, but it's still the day. We face injustice in this country, but it's still the day. Regardless of who wins the elections or who's in the White House, it's still the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, because every day is a day of thanksgiving. God's been good to us. Every day he's blessing us. Every day is a day of thanksgiving. Take the time to glorify the Lord today. Why? He keeps blessing me, opening doors that I cannot see. So take the time to glorify the Lord today. But what will you tell the Lord in your circumstances? Hear what you ought to say. For every mountain you brought me over, for every trial you've seen me through, for every blessing, hallelujah, for this I give you praise, because this is the day that the Lord has made. We ought to rejoice and be glad in it. It is still the day.
Thank you so much for joining us for our second night of revival, Dr. Watson, and we thank you for that powerful word. All right, guys, this concludes our second night of the Praise 104.1 Spring Revival. I'm Ronette Rollins, and I want to thank our sponsors from Living Well. They are leading people to healthier and more spiritually meaningful lives. You can check them out at 12004 Cherry Hill Road in Silver Spring, Maryland, or visit them online at www.livingwellabc.com. Now, make sure that you join us and come back again tomorrow night for another word from the Lord for Praise 104.1's Spring Revival. See you next time.